back into the fight.
Late summer and autumn of 1940, Britain's cities, and in particular London, suffered a series of sustained and devastating attacks by the Luftwaffe. The attacks persisted into 1941, causing immense damage and much loss of life. But by June of that year, they had petered out almost completely. Improvements in Britain's air defenses almost certainly contributed to this respite. But the principal reason for the discontinuance of these attacks was the consuming commitment of the Luftwaffe in Hitler's massive and almost recklessly ambitious invasion of the Soviet Union. The campaign in Russia was not expected to last for more than a few months. Little provision had been made for a winter campaign. And the underlying assumption amongst Luftwaffe commanders was that their forces would be redeployed against England in 1942. The failure of the German armies outside Moscow in December 1941 and the climactic events in the Pacific in the same month that brought America into the war against Germany seriously jeopardized any Luftwaffe strategy for a renewed assault on Britain. The vast potential of American industry would ensure, at least, that the air defenses of Britain would be powerfully augmented. But the mood of popular elation and the belief in Britain that a vital turning point had been reached contrasted darkly with official unease and a growing sense of anxiety. Virtually from the outbreak of hostilities, British intelligence had been receiving reports that Germany was secretly developing a new range of weapons. In charge of the investigation of these reports was the young Oxford scientist, Dr. R.V. Jones, a physicist and an expert on the interpretation of intelligence data. Early in the war, British intelligence learned of a speech made by Hitler in Danzig, in which he warned that Germany was developing a weapon against which no defense would prevail. Another report came from a source in Oslo in Norway. This described the development of a powerful long-range rocket being constructed at a remote peninsula on the Baltic coast known as Peenemünde. Jones realized that if these reports were true, German scientists had begun to develop a whole new dimension in warfare, one which could tip the balance of the conflict in favor of the Third Reich. The development and subsequent use of these weapons was one of the most closely guarded secrets of Hitler's Germany, and it had posed questions which have baffled historians ever since. How did Nazi scientists manage to perfect a weapon of such technical brilliance and sophistication? A weapon so far advanced that scientists in the United States and Great Britain considered its construction impossible. Why did Hitler become so confident that the rocket could win him the war? Did he have plans to arm the weapon not only with conventional explosives, but also with poison gas, deadly germs, or even an atomic bomb? German scientists had been working on the problems of long-range rocket flight since early in the 1930s. Experiments conducted under the auspices of the German Army's ballistics section had seen the evolution of a design for a rocket capable of flight over hundreds of kilometers. Significant problems still remain, but by 1942, the rocket scientists were on the verge of success. A further stimulus and strategic rationale for the rocket development was the accelerating pace of the Allied bombing offensive. In 1939, Hitler had promised the German people that no bombs would ever fall on their cities. In 1942, the historic centers of Hamburg and Lübeck were only two of a number of German cities savagely laid waste by the RAF. By 1943, Allied bombers were raiding Germany day and night, showering a rain of terror and death on the civilian population. Enraged by this carnage, Hitler swore revenge and retribution on his enemies. In the summer of 1943, he would be shown the weapon on which he would pin his hopes for that revenge. On the 8th of July, Hitler received a deputation from Peenemünde. It was led by General Walter Dornberger, an artilleryman and a scientist. Dornberger had been the leader of the project to develop a long-range rocket since its inception. With him was the brilliant young scientist Werner von Braun. Son of a Prussian aristocrat, von Braun combined a technical genius with a far-reaching vision of the rocket's potential. Dornberger and von Braun brought with them a film that showed some of the remarkable technical advances made by the scientists at Peenemünde. While the film was shown to Hitler, von Braun explained how the problems of long-range rocket flight had been solved. A revolutionary new means of propulsion, mixing liquid oxygen with pure alcohol, had been developed. The problem of guiding the rocket at great height and over long distances had been solved by using complex gyroscopes, which operated graphite rudders inside the rocket's exhaust. It had been found that ordinary metal melted to liquid in the intense heat generated by the propulsion unit. A remarkable new turbine pumping system had been devised to feed the rocket's massive appetite for fuel. The rocket devoured 248 pounds of fuel every second. Von Braun explained how the problems of vertical takeoff, with the rocket gradually tipping over to an angle of 49 degrees, had been solved, and how a sophisticated cooling system using a separate supply of alcohol had been perfected. Hitler was shown the static testing of the rocket's drive. The awesome weapon generated 24 million pounds of thrust per second, sufficient to visibly stress the iron girders holding the propulsion unit. After the technical features of the rocket had been outlined, Hitler was shown the preparations for launch being made in the giant hangar at Peenemünde. At 46 feet long and weighing 12 tons, the rocket was a truly impressive sight and represented the culminating achievement of 15 years of research and development. It also represented a huge and continuing commitment of German technology, science, and engineering. After being mounted on its transport unit, the rocket was taken to the launch site. Here, it was raised using a specially designed hydraulic ramp. Once in position, final checks were made to the gyroscopes and guidance system, and the fuel was added. Hitler was shown the first successful launch. Rising out of the pine forests of the Baltic shore, the rocket hurtled skywards. Von Braun explained to Hitler that it had reached a height of 50 miles, higher than any earthly object had ever been before. To Hitler, it seemed that he now held in his hands the ultimate terror weapon, the weapon against which no defense could prevail. On that July day, Hitler took a fateful and far-reaching decision. Swearing revenge and annihilation on his enemies, he ordered priority for the rocket above all other weapons of the war. Hitler's decision would prove crucial to the entire course of the conflict. As scarce industrial resources were channeled into the rocket program at the expense of other equally vital projects. The development of a jet fighter was one such casualty. By far the best and fastest aircraft of the war, the Messerschmitt 262 was consequently never produced in sufficient numbers to challenge Allied superiority in the air. The development of the flying bomb was also affected, as was the production of a whole new generation of heavyweight tanks. The priority given to rocket production raises a number of puzzling questions about the whole direction of the secret weapons project. Why was Hitler so concerned that Germany should concentrate the focus of its industrial and scientific effort on the development of the rocket? What dark intention underpinned Hitler's boast to Mussolini that his secret weapon would turn London into a garden of ruins? A boast repeated with obvious relish to party comrades and Wehrmacht generals. Was there any truth in the report received by British intelligence in 1943 that Nazi scientists were planning to arm the rocket with an atom-splitting explosive? At the very least, this and other ominous reports determined the British on a plan to destroy the rocket facilities at the earliest possible opportunity. On August the 17th, 1943, nearly 600 bombers took off from airfields in southern England. Their target, the Baltic Peninsula of Peenemünde. The urgent need to destroy the facilities there had been graphically underlined by aerial reconnaissance photographs taken only a few weeks earlier. Under minute examination by Dr. Jones, one remarkable photograph revealed a large rocket resting vertically on its test stand, waiting to be launched, and another lying on its side nearby. The discovery represented the fruits of nearly 4 years of painstaking intelligence gathering by Jones. Nearly 2,000 tons of high explosive and incendiary bombs were dropped on Peenemünde, killing over 700 workers and badly damaging the huge complex of laboratories and factories. The raid did not completely destroy the facilities, but it did enough to convince the Germans that work on the rocket should be moved to a location well out of the reach of Allied bombers. On August the 23rd, 1943, less than a week after the raid on Peenemünde, Albert Speer, the armaments minister, and Heinrich Himmler, head of the SS, met with Hitler to discuss new arrangements for rocket production. Testing and development were to be transferred from Peenemünde to Blizna, a village in Poland, now commandeered by the SS and under command of SS General Hans Kamper. Production of the rocket was to be transferred to an underground factory being excavated near Nordhausen in the Harz Mountains. When completed, the central works would be the largest underground factory in the world, producing principal rockets but also flying bombs and jets. The SS was to supply labor from the concentration camp of Buchenwald, supervisors and guards. A large SS barracks would be built and a sub-camp of Buchenwald known as Dora erected. By 1944, the entire rocket program would have been taken over by the SS. Despite the setbacks caused by the bombing of Peenemünde, work on the rocket pressed ahead. Hitler had hoped to have the rocket in service early in 1944. But with the transfer of production to the Harz Mountains and operational testing to Poland, technical troubles now came thick and fast. Some rockets exploded during re-entry to the Earth's atmosphere. Some unaccountably stopped burning after liftoff and dropped back to the Earth to explode. Others dropped back on the launch site itself. By now, both sides were engaged in a desperate race against time. The German High Command knew that to achieve maximum effect, the secret weapons must be ready before the expected Allied invasion in the summer. The Allies were similarly aware that whatever the new weapons might carry, a bombardment of southern England during the critical final preparations for the invasion could dislocate their entire strategy. During the first few months of 1944, the Allies launched a series of heavy bombing offensives against targets in the Pas de Calais. From intelligence reports and aerial reconnaissance, they had learned that the Germans planned to launch their new weapons from specially prepared sites in this area. The destruction of the launch sites, it was hoped, would at least delay the offensive until after the invasion. For the Allies, the invasion of Normandy was the most climactic and hazardous operation of the war. It represented the culmination of 2 years of planning and preparation. Every effort had been made to ensure the optimal prospects of success. No less essential to that success had been the efforts to disrupt and derail the secret weapons program. Indeed, these efforts had ensured that not a single flying bomb or rocket had been launched by the Germans during the critical opening phases of the battle. Not until the 13th of June, 7 days after the initial landings, did the flying bomb offensive finally get underway. The offensive was to continue for 3 months. In all, over 2,500 flying bombs were launched against London from newly constructed and heavily camouflaged sites in the Pas de Calais. Although the flying bombs brought a rain of terror to London and killed over 6,000 people, they failed to significantly influence the outcome of the Battle for France. Some fighter groups were redeployed on home defense duties, and the anti-aircraft batteries were moved to the coast. But the Allied advance through Normandy continued remorselessly, and by the beginning of September, the Pas de Calais had been cleared, and the flying bomb threat to London extinguished. Only one significant weapon now remained in Hitler's arsenal. During the spring and summer of 1944, the remaining technical problems bedeviling the rocket were finally ironed out. Its late deployment, however, rendered obsolete plans and preparations to launch the rockets from a line of concrete bunkers along a coastal front 250 miles long. But the mobility of the rocket and simplicity of its launching system enabled it to be fired from constantly changing and unprepared sites. Traveling in convoy with its fuel tankers and launch crew, the rocket was a highly mobile tactical weapon. The transporter unit was designed to serve also as inspection gantry and firing frame. and the range of the rocket enabled it to be fired from bases on the Dutch coast. On September the 8th, General Kammler launched his first rocket against London from The Hague. The rocket was indeed a magnificent technical achievement. When it re-entered the Earth's atmosphere over London, it would be traveling at over 3,000 miles per hour, almost invisible and utterly silent. In Britain, the arrival of the rockets was met with a wall of official secrecy. Impacts and casualty figures, even the very existence of the new weapon, were suppressed for fear of provoking panic among the civilian population. Among intelligence services, grave concerns still persisted about the ultimate purpose of the rocket. Earlier in 1944, General George Marshall, Chief of Staff of the American Army, sent General Jacob Devers to warn Churchill that the rocket might be designed to carry a far more sinister cargo than just conventional explosives. Marshall and Devers believed the rocket would be used as a weapon of last resort, to carry either radioactive waste or deadly bacteria. American intelligence had further established that some 40 German factories had been converted to the production of bacterial yeast. Throughout the winter months of 1944 and 45, a weary London endured the rocket onslaught, as a total of around 500 missiles brought death and destruction to the capital. But the dreaded attack with gas, bacteria, or atomic waste never came. On March the 7th, 1945, units of the American First Army surprised the German defenders and captured the Remagen Bridge intact, opening a major highway across the Rhine and into the heart of Germany. On March the 27th, Kammler, fearing he would be cut off in The Hague, fired his last rocket against London and began the long retreat through northern Holland towards the Rhine. Mystery still surrounds the fate of Hans Kammler, although it is believed he may have been killed by the advancing Red Army in May 1945. A bigger mystery, however, surrounds the rockets themselves. Why did Hitler choose to develop such a complex and costly weapon at the expense of Germany's flying bomb, jet, and tank building programs, and yet arm it with only a small warhead of conventional explosive? Did he, as the Americans feared, have plans to arm the weapon with gas, bacteria, or atomic waste? Or was Hitler simply seduced by the technical brilliance and awe-inspiring spectacle of the rocket into constructing a weapon which, by its intrinsic sophistication, could never be produced in sufficient numbers to markedly alter the course of the conflict? With the collapse of German resistance in May 1945, work on the rocket project came to an end. Amongst the hundreds of thousands of German soldiers who surrendered to the Allies were von Braun and Dornberger. Within a few months, both men, plus other key German rocket scientists, would be spirited to America. Complete and partially completed rockets from the factory at Nordhausen were also shipped to the United States. Together, these men and machines would form the basis of the American space program, ironically ensuring that the rocket endured as one of the few lasting achievements of Hitler's Reich. Third Reich and the sinister emblem that would strike terror into the hearts of Britons. Since 1945, historians have been preoccupied with explaining the dramatic rise to power of the Nazi Party and of its leader Adolf Hitler, the causes of the Second World War, and the course of events which led to the final destruction of Nazi Germany. So many were the questions to be answered that only recently have researchers begun to investigate the origins of the strange beliefs which lay behind the most evil movement in history. Beliefs which will forever be associated with the swastika. Where did the hooked cross, the swastika, actually come from? Was it really a Buddhist symbol of good luck, reversed in a sinister gesture by Adolf Hitler himself? Did the SS really send teams of archaeologists on expeditions in search of ancient swastikas? Is it true that the Nazi Party was founded by an occultist secret society called Thu, whose swastika emblem it adopted? In the late 1800s, many Westerners, disillusioned by the modern industrial world, looked to the hidden kingdom of Tibet as a source of ancient mystical wisdom. In 1875, a Russian adventuress and self-proclaimed clairvoyant, Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, founded the Theosophical Society, whose teachings were based on experiences she claimed to have had in an underground monastery in the Himalayas. In 1888, Blavatsky published a book, The Secret Doctrine, which purported to show how the universe had passed through seven cycles or rounds, each cycle associated with seven races. She identified the present time as the fourth cosmic round, a period which would be dominated by the fifth root race, a race of supermen she called the Aryans. Up to now, the term Aryan had been used to mean a group of languages originating in India, never a race or a people. The idea of an Aryan race was a fantasy, but thanks to Madame Blavatsky, belief in the existence of the Aryans would gradually take root amongst spiritualists and mystics the world over. Madame Blavatsky was uniquely responsible for one other innovation. She claimed that amongst all the mystical signs and symbols revealed to her, one was the special emblem of the Aryans. That sign was the swastika. For centuries, the swastika had appeared in the Buddhist world as a symbol of good fortune. In Tibet, the swastika was the sign of Agni, the god of fire and creation. The swastika was also to be found in the ancient cultures of South America, West Africa, the Mediterranean, and Northern Europe. Scholars believe that in all these cultures, the swastika represented the swirling rays of the sun. Madame Blavatsky's theosophical teachings soon spread throughout the United States of America and on into Europe. She was particularly popular in Germany and Austria, and there, the swastika, the emblem she had chosen for her theosophical society, became widely known. In the years leading up to the First World War, German-speaking Austrians were an ethnic minority, many of whom longed to be united with Germany. Societies were founded devoted to German culture and history. and one man quickly became the spiritual leader of the Austrian-German cause. Guido von List was an enormously popular occultist writer who claimed psychic visions of the distant past. He made a special study of the runes, an ancient system of writing used by the Vikings and other Nordic peoples. List believed that the runes were magical symbols, and influenced by Madame Blavatsky, he chose the swastika, to the Vikings the rune of the god Thor, as the most potent symbol. Following Blavatsky, he claimed that the swastika was the sign of the Aryans, and he argued the purest descendants of the ancient Aryans were the Germans. By the outbreak of the First World War in 1914, Guido von List had tens of thousands of followers. Societies had been formed to propagate his teachings and to plan for the German Empire that List was by now foretelling. In the German and Austrian trenches, List's works were read eagerly. The swastika, the symbol that List had adopted as the sign of the Aryans, had become hugely popular. And swastika talismans designed by List's followers were sold to the troops. Already, the swastika, as the new symbol of militant German nationalism, was being painted unofficially on the sides of German aircraft. To millions of Germans, defeat in 1918 came as a shattering blow. They'd been promised an empire and had instead been humiliated. In the last year of the war, there'd been some dramatic German successes, albeit short-lived. And it seemed to many that there was only one explanation for defeat. Germany had been betrayed from within. Senior army officers, to hide their own failures, quickly cast about for an alibi. They placed the blame squarely on the shoulders of Democrats, communists, and Jews. The abdication of the Emperor Kaiser Wilhelm was the final blow. Overnight, the old Germany had virtually disappeared. A once proud nation had been reduced to a bankrupt and defenseless beggary, presided over by squabbling politicians. Worst of all, Germany, with millions of trained and embittered war veterans on the streets, was quickly descending into anarchy and civil war. Throughout 1918 and 1919, the infant Weimar Republic was rocked by clashes between communists and right-wingers. There were attempted coups in Berlin, in the Ruhr, and in Bavaria. Amongst the right-wing factions, the dreams of an Aryan empire propagated by Guido von List had not been forgotten. The Free Corps, bands of armed veterans organized to fight the communists and defend Germany's borders, adopted as their symbol the swastika. Guido von List's mystical doctrines of Aryan supremacy had by now given rise to a nationwide secret society calling itself the German Order. Its membership was made up of aristocrats, businessmen, and wealthy professionals. And the order was deeply anti-Semitic and anti-democratic. its members were bound together by occult rituals inspired by Liszt. The Munich Lodge of the German Order was called the Thule Society, after the mythical northern homeland of the Aryan race. The symbol of the Thule Society was the swastika. While German nationalists were adopting the swastika as the emblem of Aryan supremacy, at the same time, under the influence of Madame Blavatsky's theosophy, fascination with the swastika was growing throughout the Western world. The British author Rudyard Kipling's stories of India appeared decorated with a swastika. In Scotland, the discovery of swastika markings in a Pictish cave inspired the creation of the swastika kilt pin. In the United States, costly earrings and brooches were designed in the form of the swastika. During the Great War, the British War Savings Drive had a swastika as its official emblem. Its administrators were awarded swastika lapel badges in recognition of their services to the nation. While members of British mystical circles and druidic cults displayed swastikas on their ceremonial robes. Meanwhile, in Germany, the swastika was about to become the official emblem of a new political party. In late 1918, the Munich Lodge of the German Order, the Thule Society, decided to create a workers' discussion group. Soon after, Anton Drexler, a locksmith and the group's most active member, proposed that they develop it into a political party. The Thule Society agreed, and on January the 19th, 1919, the new party had its first meeting in the Fürstenfelder Hof Tavern in Munich. It was named the German Workers' Party. Since the end of the Great War, the activities of right-wing political parties, the armed militias of the Free Corps, and the massive organizations of war veterans had been of the greatest interest to the German army. After the Treaty of Versailles, the victorious Western Allies had imposed strict limits on the German armed forces. The army couldn't exceed 100,000 men, and the weapons it could possess were strictly controlled. The army command, sympathetic to the aims of right-wing groups such as the German Order, armed and trained the Free Corps as a secret reserve, and were constantly on the lookout for promising political groups to support. To this end, it employed spies, trusted army veterans, some still serving soldiers, to report on the aims and loyalties of new parties. One such spy was the 30-year-old Corporal Adolf Hitler. On September the 12th, 1919, Hitler attended a meeting of the German Workers' Party. Within weeks, he had joined the party under army instructions. Soon, he was the most popular speaker at party meetings. And within weeks, had risen to become head of propaganda. On February the 20th, 1920, the party changed its name to the National Socialist German Workers' Party. The following May, it adopted as its symbol the emblem of its parent, the Thule Society. The symbol was the swastika. It was Hitler himself, as head of propaganda and an amateur artist, who designed the swastika flag adopted by the new Nazi party. the curved swastika of Thule was replaced by the straight-armed form. The swastika was black and placed inside a white circle on a red background. Black, white, and red were the colors of the old German imperial flag. There's been much speculation that Hitler deliberately reversed the direction of the original Tibetan swastika in a sinister gesture, transforming it from a symbol of good luck into an emblem of evil. In fact, until now, the swastika as used by German occultists, right-wing political groups, and the Free Corps had no set direction. Both clockwise and anti-clockwise forms were commonplace. Why did Hitler choose the anti-clockwise tilted swastika for the Nazi Party? Recently discovered records of a conversation between Hitler and a senior Nazi official have revealed the true reason. Hitler argued that since the swastika was the Aryan symbol of the sun, it must appear as the sun would have appeared to the ancient Aryans in their northern homeland of Thule. The sun would have seemed to roll across the horizon from east to west. The true swastika of the Aryans must therefore, Hitler argued, appear to roll anti-clockwise. Although the most common form of Nazi swastika was straight-armed, the curved swastika of Thule was not forgotten by the Nazi Party to which it gave birth. It appeared on the belt buckles of the brown-shirted stormtroopers. Decorations for anti-partisan warfare on the Eastern Front displayed both the Thule swastika and dagger. The tanks of the SS Division Nordland also showed the Thule swastika. Whatever the form in which the swastika appeared in the banners and regalia of National Socialism, its meaning remained the same. It was the meaning claimed for it by Madame Blavatsky and Guido von List. It was the symbol of the Aryans. In Hitler's words, the swastika was the sign of the mystical destiny of Aryan man. The Nazi fascination with swastika led to an extraordinary mission, a mission inspired by the SS and encouraged by Adolf Hitler. It was an attempt to trace the history of the Aryan race, a race that in reality existed only in the imagination of mystics. In 1935, an institution calling itself the Annenerbe was established by the Nazi government and soon came under the control of the SS. The Annenerbe, the ancestral heritage society for the study of Germanic prehistory, would grow to over 50 departments and control all archaeology in the Third Reich. Its official task was to show that the Aryans had spread from their ancestral lands in the north and had founded the great civilizations of history. All over the world, Annenerbe archaeologists searched for ancient swastikas to prove their claims. Wherever swastikas were found, they concluded that there had once flourished an Aryan civilization. The purpose of proving that all the greatest cultures had been founded by Aryans was to show that the Germans, the Aryans' supposed descendants, had a natural right to conquer at will and reclaim their ancient heritage. In 1937, in the city of Munich, National Socialism celebrated the supremacy of the Aryans and their imagined history as the origin of all cultural achievements. Everywhere there are swastikas, venerated as the symbol of the Aryan racial destiny. Under the Nazis, the myth of the Aryan, propagated by the occultists of an earlier generation, was transformed into a state religion. The sign of this new religion was the swastika, the National Socialist substitute for the Christian cross. While the majority of the German people are skeptical or even hostile to the party's attempts to replace Christianity, and Hitler is wary of direct conflict with the Christian churches, the Nazis believe that they have time on their side. All German youth must be members of one of the party organizations for young people. And it is in these that the new creed is most blatantly preached. In the rituals of the Hitler Youth, readings from the Bible are replaced by readings from Mein Kampf. A Hitler Youth hymn is taught, "No evil priest can prevent us from feeling that we are the children of Hitler. Away with incense and holy water. The swastika brings salvation on earth." In the League of German Maidens, the Nazi youth organization for girls, pageants are held in which the curved swastika, a legacy of the Thule Society, was carried in procession. And the supposed religious rites of ancient Germanic tribes reenacted. The official German calendar was also changed. All references to Christmas were banned and removed from school books. Instead, there was a winter festival dedicated to the sun. The summer solstice, too, became an official holy day, in which ceremonial fires were lit all over the Reich. In nocturnal rituals, Nazi gatherings chanted fire incantations. In the new Nordic religion of the Nazis, the fantasies of the Germanic mystic Guido von Liszt had become a reality. So too had the Aryan Empire he preached. With Hitler's program of conquest and racial annihilation, the swastika flew triumphant over vast tracts of Europe and the Soviet Union. Less than 60 years after Madame Blavatsky had identified the swastika as the sign of the Aryans, it had completed its transformation. From the Buddhist symbol of good fortune, the swastika had become the most feared and hated symbol in the history of the human race. March 1945, 5 weeks before the collapse of the Third Reich. The Allied armies are sweeping through Germany. For the Nazi leaders, the end is in sight. Many are already frantically destroying evidence they know would expose their deepest secrets. One such man was Heinrich Himmler, leader of the SS. On Friday, March the 30th, 1945, Himmler summoned to his presence SS Major Heinz Macher. He gave Macher a very special mission. He was to take a demolition squad deep into the Westphalian countryside. The purpose was to destroy an ancient castle. A castle which few outside the secretive elite of the SS had ever entered. It was the SS Order Castle of Wabelsburg. The fortress which Himmler had seen as the very center of his SS empire was to be left in ruins. The Castle of Wabelsburg is the site of one of the strangest mysteries of the Second World War. What is behind persistent rumors that deep in the castle crypt, Himmler and his senior SS leaders held mystical rituals? Was the site really chosen for Himmler by his personal clairvoyant advisor? Was it really intended that Wabelsburg should become the Vatican City of an SS state? Only recently have historians even begun to understand the bizarre story of Himmler's castle. By 1934, Himmler had established his SS as the personal bodyguard of Adolf Hitler and the elite force of the Nazi Party. Himmler was becoming, after Adolf Hitler himself, the most powerful man in the Third Reich. Yet, even amongst his fellow Nazi leaders, many of Himmler's most cherished beliefs were seen as the ravings of a madman. To the consternation of many in the Nazi Party, Himmler made no secret of his fascination with the occult. He was obsessed by astrology and firmly believed in reincarnation. Himmler spoke freely of his conviction that he was the reincarnation of the 10th century Saxon king Henry the Fowler. Every year on the anniversary of the king's death, Himmler would solemnly lay a wreath on his grave and then banish his subordinates to meditate in solitude. Himmler became convinced that he could enter into psychic communication with the dead king. He also believed that he had inherited the king's mission to conquer the East and create an Aryan empire. Himmler told his SS, "We assemble and march according to unalterable laws as a national socialist order of Nordic men and as a sworn community on our way to a far future." In devising rituals and practices for his Nordic order, Himmler looked for inspiration to the Teutonic tribes of Germany's distant past. To advise him, he recruited into the SS a renowned psychic, Karl Willigut, a man whose claim is to be the last in a long line of Aryan high priests. Willigut deeply impressed Himmler. He was soon given the rank of SS Brigadier on Himmler's personal staff. Heinrich Himmler, with the help of Karl Willigut, now planned the strangest of all his creations, an SS center that would become the focus of his power and the capital of a future SS state. Himmler spent months looking for just the right site. He found it in Paderborn in Westphalia. The castle of Wabelsburg had been built in the early 1600s on the site of a 10th century Saxon fort. Its romantic history strongly appealed to him. What is more, Karl Willigut told him of an ancient prophecy in which Wabelsburg was destined to become a magical German stronghold in a future conflict between Europe and Asia. The prophecy coincided exactly with Himmler's belief that the SS would in the near future conquer the East and carve an SS state from the ruins of the Soviet Union. Imler began the massive task of reconstructing the castle in late 1934. Wewelsburg was to be utterly transformed. To the outside world, Himmler's SS Castle was to be a leadership school and study center. But in reality, Himmler was planning to create an SS Vatican City. Wewelsburg was to be the venue for the most secret of all SS rituals. For years, Himmler had pondered the question of how his SS order was to be governed. Taking his inspiration from the Knights of the Round Table, he appointed a shadowy inner council of 12 senior SS leaders. For Himmler's chosen 12, Wewelsburg was to be the inspirational setting for solemn meditation and the performance of secret Germanic rituals inspired by Karl Willigut. In the massive north tower of the castle was an inner sanctum, a vast circular hall, its walls 12 feet thick. Around the chamber stood 12 columns. On the floor was a mosaic of swastikas, forming a sun wheel of 12 lightning flashes. In this strange chamber, Himmler would instruct his 12 knights to enter into spiritual communion with what he believed to be the Aryan race soul and the spirits of the Germanic ancestors. Deep below the inner sanctum, cut into the solid bedrock, was the crypt called Valhalla. The precise nature of the rituals carried out there still remains a mystery. Not one of those who were present ever divulged the truth. But historians have suggested that amongst other ceremonies, the crypt was intended to be the scene of solemn death rituals. In the center, the wooden coats of arms of dead SS knights were to be ceremonially burned. 12 stone plinths around the walls were to hold 12 urns, each of which would, one day, contain the armorial ashes of a departed leader. In the crypt burned an eternal flame, symbol of the everlasting mission of the SS in the service of the Aryan race. It is known that Himmler's most cherished ambition was that one day, the crypt at Wewelsburg would hold the tomb of Adolf Hitler. Germany's astonishing victories in the first 2 years of war had served only to confirm Himmler's belief that in the thousand-year Reich to come, the SS would play the key role. His SS military formations had won the grudging admiration of even the German regular army, so great was their fanaticism. While the Waffen-SS would expand to 40 divisions, Himmler's empire also encompassed hundreds of factories and mines, all of the Reich's concentration camps, and hundreds of thousands of slave laborers. Now Himmler began to plan the most grandiose of all his fantastic schemes, the expansion of Wewelsburg into an SS capital city. The North Tower, with its sacred hall and underground vault, was to be the center point of vast circular grounds. Surrounding them was to be built an enormous complex of libraries and research institutes for astrology, astronomy, and Teutonic history. Ringing the city would be walls over 40 feet high. Even the ground plan was of mystical significance. It represented the head of a spear, its tip pointing to the north. The cost of realizing Himmler's vision was to be 300 million marks, an extraordinary sum. The entire project was to be completed sometime in the 1960s. By then, Himmler believed the SS would possess its own independent state, a state founded on the territory of a conquered Soviet Union. With victory, every SS man would be given a farm and every officer an estate. Himmler's SS nobles would rule as the feudal overlords of Russian slaves and German settler farmers. From Wewelsburg, Himmler himself would preside over his empire as the Grand Master of the SS Order. To Heinrich Himmler, Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union in June 1941, promised the fulfillment of all his dreams. In reality, the Nazi war in the East would spell the beginning of the end of Nazi Germany and of Himmler's terrifying vision. By April 1945, Himmler's castle was a blackened shell, destroyed on Himmler's own orders. At once it was plundered by local villagers in search of valuables, and much of its contents simply vanished. Himmler's castle did, however, contain one final secret. In the deepest cellar of the West Tower was Himmler's personal safe. Not even the castle's SS commandants had known of its existence. Several days after the castle was first entered by the Allies, an American special unit blew open the safe and removed the piles of documents and valuables they found inside. The men and the documents then disappeared from history. Japan's Day of Infamy, December the 7th, 1941. Without warning or any declaration of war, the Japanese launched their campaign of conquest in the Pacific. At Pearl Harbor, the American Pacific Fleet is crippled by waves of aircraft flying from carriers. Most of the island's complement of 400 aircraft are destroyed on the ground. Elsewhere, the events are equally catastrophic. Japanese troops land in Malaya, Thailand, Hong Kong, and the Philippines. On December the 8th, President Roosevelt declares war on Japan.
That since
But there is no similar state of war declared between America and Germany, and no apparent intention to do so.
On Sunday, December 7th, 1941.
Indeed, the events of December 7th have largely rendered this politically impossible. Popular outrage at the Japanese action will ensure that she will claim priority in all American strategic plans. For Hitler, the Japanese attack must have come as a welcome relief. In the Atlantic, American warships had been covertly assisting the British in convoy protection. On the Eastern Front, the German Blitzkrieg had been brought to a bloody halt at the gates of Moscow. partly with the aid of American military supplies. These exasperating interferences would now be radically constrained by the military requirements of engaging Japan in the Pacific. Yet, on December the 11th, after a delay of 4 days, in which the new, more favorable military situation had become abundantly clear, Hitler inexplicably declared war on America. The event is all the more remarkable as it is the only occasion on which Hitler ever publicly declared his intention to wage war. Neither then nor since have any convincing explanations been offered for this unique and uncharacteristic action of Hitler's. Why did Hitler declare war on the world's foremost industrial power? Did he have plans to attack America? And if so, with what forces or weapons? Did he plan to aid Japan in her conquest of the Pacific? And if so, how? Or were there strategic imperatives known only to Hitler, which compelled a high-risk strategy of globalizing what was, for Germany, essentially a European conflict? Two significant themes can be discerned in Hitler's military and strategic planning. The first of these guiding principles, if they can be so called, was never declare war. The second was to endeavor to ensure that Germany never became involved in a war on two fronts. When he attacked Poland in 1939, he did so without any declaration of war, and in the conviction that neither Britain nor France would come to her aid. Events served only to confirm the wisdom of this prediction. Although declarations of war were issued by both these countries, neither betrayed the slightest inclination to attack Germany. The swift reduction of Poland, coupled with a strange tranquility on the Franco-German frontier, encouraged in Hitler a not unreasonable belief that a peaceful resolution of the conflict was still possible. In both Britain and France, there were grave anxieties about the potential cost of a European war, and no great anguish about the fate of Poland. In September, Hitler had expressed genuine astonishment at the British declaration of war, and had informed Alfred Rosenberg of his intention to propose a peace conference to resolve any outstanding problems, and to secure an honorable settlement in the West. Peace feelers were later secretly extended through Spain and the Vatican. It is against this background of secret diplomacy that the early prosecution of the war in the Atlantic must be viewed. Hitler had made scant provision for a war at sea, and even less for a war with Britain. At the outbreak of hostilities, the German Navy had less than 40 U-boats available for service, and their effectiveness was further limited by Hitler's refusal to sanction attacks on the vessels of neutral nations. The dilemma confronting Hitler was, to what extent could the U-boat war be prosecuted without provoking America? From the outset, Admiral Raeder, Commander-in-Chief of the Navy, had pressed for an all-out effort to blockade Britain and bring her to terms. But Hitler would not countenance an unrestricted U-boat offensive, and forbade any actions that might threaten German-American relations. Yet, if Hitler displayed the formalities of respect for neutral shipping, he displayed none at all for that of nations. In the spring of 1940, the German war machine moved into top gear. Despairing of a peaceful settlement in the West, Hitler launched his armies into the neutral states of Norway, Denmark, Holland, and Belgium. The destruction of the neutrals outraged American public opinion, but far worse, it exposed the long left flank of the Allies to an armored thrust through the Ardennes. The line was broken near Sedan on the Franco-Belgian frontier. And by June, the panzers were racing to an undeniable triumph in the west. With France prostrate and the British driven en route from continental Europe, Mussolini declared Italian entry to the war and attacked France through the Alpine passes in what Hitler dubbed little more than a looting expedition. "This must be the last declaration of war in history," he exclaimed. "I never thought the Duce was so primitive. Never in my life will I sign a declaration of war. I will always strike first." But the capitulation of France and the intervention of Italy radically altered the military balance of power and placed Britain in a position of grave peril. In the Mediterranean, the shipping lanes were now closed to all but the most heavily protected convoys. In the Atlantic, the war was beginning to swing decisively in favor of Germany. Operating from new bases in France and Norway, the U-boats were able to range far and wide. Between July and October, while the RAF was committed to the Battle of Britain, sinkings averaged over 100 a month. U-boats called this period the happy time. But the latter half of 1940 also saw the first ominous moves to rearm America and align her more firmly with Britain. In July, President Roosevelt signed the Two Ocean Navy Act, initiating a massive program of naval expansion, designed to provide America with the most modern and powerful fleet in the world. In September, Roosevelt and Churchill concluded the Destroyers for Bases deal. This provided Britain with 50 desperately needed destroyers in exchange for leases on British bases in the Caribbean. 2 weeks later, Congress passed the Selective Service Act, introducing peacetime conscription for the first time in America's history. In response to these developments, Italy, Germany, and Japan signed the Tripartite Pact. For Hitler, this agreement was intended primarily as a diplomatic gesture, designed to intimidate America and to ensure her continued neutrality. There were no binding commitments on any party to go to war in support of another. But the Tripartite Pact was to have an effect opposite to that intended. It provided Roosevelt with ample justification for continuing his policy of rearmament and for his ever more blatant disregard for American neutrality. In January 1941, Roosevelt called for an escalation in American military aid to Britain.
"Manufacture additional munitions and war supplies of many kinds to be turned over to those nations which are now
in March, Lend-Lease, as it was known, was passed by Congress. The act provided for privileged terms to be afforded to Britain for the purchase of military equipment and supplies. But in its wider ramifications, the act effectively discarded any remaining pretense at American impartiality. Although American arms production was as yet less than that of Britain, Lend-Lease would enable the American munitions industry to be more rapidly expanded. And by 1943, American arms production would be of staggering proportions. A further effect of the act was to exacerbate the already tense situation in the Atlantic. American warships had been covertly assisting the Royal Navy for much of 1940. But Lend-Lease now allowed them even greater discretion, and many convoys were now given American protection for the first part of their journey. Lend-Lease was also to have significant ramifications in Germany. At a series of secret conferences held at the Berghof, Hitler outlined the long-term consequences of the act. American intervention, he believed, was becoming increasingly more certain, but this could not happen before 1942. If he could resolve all his continental problems before this time, the threat of American interference would be greatly reduced. In the meantime, every effort should be made to encourage Japan to pursue an aggressive policy in the Pacific, thus distracting America from Hitler's increasingly forceful resolution of his European problems. In the spring of 1941, Hitler attacked Greece and Yugoslavia. The principal rationale for the offensive was the security of the continental coast from enemy landings and the creation of a broad front in the east. Since November of the previous year, Hitler had been drawing up plans for a lightning conquest of the Soviet Union. The reduction of the Balkan states was seen as an essential prelude to this enterprise. War with Russia, Hitler had always believed, was inevitable. Both Russia and Germany had territorial ambitions that could only be achieved at the expense of each other. Hitler knew there would be no declarations of war. Only time would tell who attacked first and with what element of surprise. In the event, only German efficiency, coupled with superior communications, afforded Hitler the stigma and rewards of the aggressor. The war in Russia was not expected to last for more than a few months. "We have only to kick in the front door," he had told his staff, "and the whole rotten edifice will come tumbling down." Out of the ruins, Hitler planned to create an Aryan superstate, populated by docile automatons and policed by the SS. The vast natural resources of European Russia would be incorporated within the German war machine, and the thousand-year Reich would become an inescapable reality. Then he would deal with his enemies in the West from a position of unassailable power. At first, it seemed that Hitler might very well succeed. The attack, perhaps incredibly, took Stalin completely by surprise. The Red Army was found ill-prepared and heavily concentrated in offensive formations close to the front line. Indeed, in the early phase of the campaign, Roosevelt's reactions proved quicker and more astute than Stalin's. 2 days after the German attack, he announced his intention to extend Lend-Lease to Russia, and in July, ordered American troops to Iceland. The peaceful occupation of Iceland provided America with a strategically pivotal air and naval base in the North Atlantic, extending American military influence and providing invaluable protection for North Atlantic convoys. But military aid and the various covert forms of assistance given to Britain and Russia were not in themselves sufficient to directly threaten Hitler. If anything, they betrayed only Roosevelt's impotence and the stubborn refusal of America to be drawn into the conflict. This fundamental weakness in American foreign policy was underlined in August when Churchill and Roosevelt met at Placenta Bay off Newfoundland. Churchill had hoped to secure wide-ranging military agreements and a firm commitment of American assistance in the defeat of Germany. But Roosevelt, hamstrung by Congress and a still powerful isolationist lobby, could offer little more than a vague and fairly meaningless statement of principles. Even the very real prospect of a Nazi empire stretching from the Atlantic to the Pacific could not, it seemed, rescue America from her complacency. But the swift conquest of Russia was proving more problematic than either Hitler or his generals had foreseen. There was universal astonishment at the sheer size of the Red Army. In the first few weeks of the campaign, the Wehrmacht destroyed over 100 Soviet divisions. By the end of October, more than 3 million prisoners had been taken. In November, however, the Germans found their advance slowed by the onset of an early winter and by hardening resistance outside Moscow. The prospect of a winter war in Russia came as a shock to the German high command. No provision had been made for a winter campaign. The army had no winter clothing, no low-temperature lubricants, no reserve supplies, and no plans. With his offensive faltering outside Moscow, Hitler was now more than ever wary of provoking America. In the Atlantic, American warships were effectively prosecuting an undeclared war. Yet the U-boats were still forbidden to engage them or to attack American merchant ships taking essential military supplies to his enemies. Increasingly, the resolution of Hitler's problems was seen to lie with Japan. If Japan could be persuaded to enter the war, Germany's strategic position would be radically improved. Since July, the German foreign minister, Joachim von Ribbentrop, had been urging the Japanese to attack Russia. But all such appeals had proved fruitless, and the arrival in America in November of a Japanese diplomatic delegation seemed to signal Japan's determination to avoid war. In December, fierce fighting erupted everywhere on the Russian front. 12 miles from Moscow, the German advance had ground to a halt in temperatures as low as minus 40 degrees centigrade. On December the 5th, Hitler called off the offensive, acknowledging the failure of his armies to conquer Russia in a single year's campaign. On the following day, the Russians launched a massive counteroffensive on either side of Moscow. Unknown to Hitler, the Japanese fleet was even then steaming towards its rendezvous with destiny at Pearl Harbor. The diplomatic efforts of November had proved little more than a cynical exercise in duplicity. The attack took the world by surprise. Hitler was stunned. Ribbentrop actually thought it was an Allied hoax. But as the first reports were followed by detailed accounts, German astonishment turned to elation and relief. American military strategy would now be directed not by cold political calculations, but by popular demands for retribution, and by the immediate tasks of containing the Japanese onslaught. American aid to Britain and Russia would be substantially reduced, and American ships would be transferred from the Atlantic to the Pacific.
North!
Yet by declaring war on America, Hitler willfully squandered all these strategic advantages. The immediate effects of unleashing the U-boats on American shipping were offset in the longer term by increasing quantities of aid and by the development of overland routes through Persia to Russia. On the Eastern Front, the crisis facing the Wehrmacht was, if anything, only exacerbated. The failure of Japan to issue reciprocal declarations of war only served to reassure the Russians of Japanese neutrality. Had Hitler's declaration of war been an attempt to draw Japan into the war with Russia? If so, there is no record of any further diplomatic efforts to achieve this. Nor were there any serious attempts to coordinate Axis strategy. Although essentially global, the war was characterized by the contrasts and peculiarities of fighting in two entirely separate theaters of conflict. In the Pacific, the war was to last longer. Japanese expansion was only completely checked in early 1943, and the task of reconquering the Pacific was always accorded lesser priority than that of defeating Germany. On the Eastern Front, the crisis of December 1941 was followed by catastrophes for the Wehrmacht in the winter of the following year. And by the summer of 1943, the effects of American entry into the war were becoming apparent in every aspect of the conflict. American troops were fighting in Italy. American aircraft were bombing Germany's cities. And American equipment was everywhere. Yet, America itself, Hitler's only declared enemy, was never once attacked by air or sea. In terms of its effects, Hitler's declaration of war is impossible to understand. Indeed, from the few surviving records, it appears that Hitler himself was never able to justify his action. Towards the end of his life, when the armies of America were sweeping across the plains of Western Germany, he would declare, "This war with America is a tragedy. Illogical, devoid of fundamental reality." Berlin, 1945. Somewhere amid the ruins of the Reich's last and most formidable citadel, Adolf Hitler contemplates the destruction of all his hopes and dreams. Few of those who shelter with him beneath the blazing heart of the city will survive to tell the story of these final terrible days. When the last pockets of resistance are liquidated and the smoke and smell of death clear from the shattered capital, all that will remain of the dark and vengeful spirit of Adolf Hitler will be a document bearing his name and reaffirming his message of hatred and annihilation. For Hitler, Berlin will serve both as epitaph and funeral pyre. No trace of him will ever be seen again. And the manner and circumstances of his death will never be fully established. For historians, the last days of Adolf Hitler, Führer of Germany, will prove as mysterious and as controversial as any other aspect of his life and work. How exactly did Hitler meet his end? Did he, as Admiral Dönitz was to announce to a stunned world, die fighting at the head of his troops? Or did he, as the Russians later claimed, commit suicide by taking poison? And if so, what became of his mortal remains? Hitler was last seen by the world on April the 20th, 1945, when he reviewed a delegation of the Hitler Youth. Then he looked gray and pale, and far older than his 56 years. But his intention at that time appears to have been to abandon Berlin in the face of devastating Russian attacks on the Oder-Neisse line. Yet only 2 days later, as the first Russian units began to penetrate the outer suburbs, Hitler appears to have resolved to remain in his capital, to personally direct its defense and to share in its fate, whatever the price. What reasoning lay behind this fateful decision? Did Hitler perhaps believe that by remaining in Berlin, he could set an example to his generals and rally his flagging armies? In the scenario of events subsequently pieced together, this appears the most likely explanation. In his interrogation after the war, Field Marshal Keitel reported that even in the last days of his life, Hitler did not completely give up hope. To support those forces still defending the capital, Hitler ordered General Wenck to disengage his 12th Army, fighting the Americans, and swing east to rescue Berlin, then only days away from encirclement. In retrospect, it is clear that any attempt to defend Berlin was doomed to failure. 12th Army was chronically short of fuel, ammunition, and supplies. On either side of Berlin, the Russian juggernaut was rolling forward inexorably. On April the 24th, an entire panzer corps fighting at the gates of Berlin simply disappeared. And on the following day, the Russians delivered a doubly lethal blow, simultaneously completing their encirclement of the capital and linking up with American forces on the Elbe, effectively slicing Germany in two. If defense in the East was wavering, defense in the West had collapsed completely. In the Ruhr, the remnants of Field Marshal Model's Rhine armies were being rounded up and marched into captivity. Model himself committed suicide rather than face the indignity of surrender. To what extent was Hitler's final resolution influenced by Model's death? Certainly, Model was one of Hitler's favorite field marshals and exemplified many of the qualities that Hitler demanded of his officers. But more importantly, Hitler regarded himself as the epitome of these qualities. In World War I, he'd been decorated for bravery in the field and never tired of reminding his generals of this distinction. To Hitler, bravery and resolve were the essential requirements of victory, and the years of war had only served to strengthen that conviction. When the Russians counterattacked outside Moscow in December 1941, Hitler overruled his generals and demanded that the line be held whatever the cost. In the winter of the following year, when General Paulus's 6th Army was trapped in Stalingrad, Hitler refused to sanction a breakout and demanded that Paulus hold his positions until his army was either relieved or destroyed. When Paulus surrendered to the Russians in an effort to spare further needless suffering, Hitler was furious, branding Paulus a coward and a traitor. In 1945, it is likely that Hitler at last recognized that he too had met his Stalingrad and resolved to follow the example of Model rather than the despised Paulus. From April 25th, hope of relief dwindled steadily. With Berlin encircled, the Russians could concentrate on battering their way through the suburbs towards the center. On the 26th, Soviet guns began targeting the Chancellery itself. For the remaining days of April, the Russian bombardment of Hitler's last refuge would be incessant and remorseless. On the 29th, Hitler inaugurated the last act in the drama. He married Eva Braun, his mistress for 14 years. After a brief ceremony, he then dictated his last will and testament. In this strange document, Hitler denied all responsibility for the war. The war, he claimed, had been forced upon him by his old enemy, international Jewry. Nor was failure his responsibility. The army had betrayed him, and the German people, in the last analysis, had proved unworthy of his leadership. Bitterly, he denounced his enemies, reaffirmed his resolve to die in Berlin, and in a final churlish gesture, appointed Admiral Dönitz as his chosen successor. By now, it was clear that the end was imminent. The Russians were advancing in every sector. There was neither food nor fuel to be had anywhere. Sewage, water supply, and power distribution systems had broken down completely, and ammunition was virtually exhausted. Soon, the Russians would be fighting in the Chancellery itself. Amongst the last reports to reach Berlin from the outside world were accounts of the deaths of Mussolini and his mistress Clara Petacci. Captured and killed by Italian partisans, their bodies were hung up and mutilated in the town square of Milan. It served as a gruesome warning to Hitler of the fate of fallen tyrants. On April 30th, Adolf Hitler and his young wife committed suicide. This fact is now largely beyond dispute. Among the few surviving witnesses, Erich Kempke, Hitler's long-serving chauffeur, testified that Hitler shot himself with a heavy revolver and that Eva Braun had taken cyanide. Kempke's testimony was independently confirmed by another witness, Arthur Axmann, head of the Hitler Youth. On May the 1st, Admiral Dönitz became the second Führer of Germany and announced in the press that Hitler had fallen in the battle for Berlin. On the following day, the remnants of the Berlin garrison surrendered. No reliable figures exist for those who lost their lives in the battle. Many, like Martin Bormann, simply disappeared. The charred bodies of Goebbels and his wife were found lying beside their children in the Chancellery garden. The ultimate fate of Adolf Hitler may never be known for certain. A corpse resembling Hitler was unearthed by the Russians, but this was almost certainly a double. Indeed, Russian accounts of the last days of Hitler are contradictory and confusing. At times, they have claimed that Hitler's body was never found. At others, that he committed suicide by taking poison. What of Hitler's mortal remains? Erich Kempke claimed to have seen both Hitler's and Eva's bodies burned with petrol in the Chancellery garden. Kempke's account was later confirmed by Heinz Linger, who had carried Hitler's body into the garden. Further confirmation came from Hitler's SS adjutant, Otto Gernscher. Gernscher, it seems, had organized the entire proceedings and had set fire to the bodies. A further morbid detail was added by Harry Mengerhausen, who claimed to have buried the charred remains of Hitler and his wife in a shell crater in the Chancellery garden. So why were the bodies never found? Could it be that the last remains of Adolf Hitler were taken in secret to Russia, a macabre souvenir of the war? Or perhaps more likely, the carcass of a dark power to be watched and guarded for eternity.